Attention bobsled riders! You will soon be embarking on a thrilling podcast down the icy slopes of the Matterhorn. So please remain seated, keeping your hands, arms, feet, and legs inside the bobsled at all times. Auf Wiedersehen!
Hello, yodelers! We are the Matterhorn Yodelers. I am your host today, Peter, with my co-host,
Jackie,
and
Japheth.
And I think we sound a little bit different today, don't we?
Yeah.
Maybe. We'll see. If we don't sound any different, it's because our new system isn't working out. But hopefully, you guys can hear an improvement on our sound.
Yeah, we've got a new setup. We look a little bit more official.
I know.
Not that looks matter in podcast.
Right. We've got the face of a podcast. All right. And today we're gonna go back in our time machine here. And we're gonna go to my favorite time of Epcot, and that's Epcot in the 80s. And we're gonna talk about some of the old OG Epcot Future World attractions. And if you guys like this, we might continue to do more of these. But we've got a couple attractions we're going to talk about today. The first one we'll talk about is Universe of Energy. And then we'll end things off with Horizons.
Got to end with a big bang.
Yes.
I didn't know Horizons had an S.
Horizons. Yes. I figured Horizons is a better finisher than Universe of Energy.
The snooze ride. It lasted longer.
Yes, it did. It did last longer than Horizons did. This is true.
It's the solar panels on it.
That's it.
They're like, well, it does provide some power.
That 15% power to the attraction really helps.
Those
out.
Dinosaurs aren't producing as much as we thought they would.
Right.
They're not decomposing, turning themselves into oil that we can burn off soon enough for... Autopia.
Right. So we're going to start off with the Universe of Energy. So Universe of Energy was always an idea for Epcot from the beginning. For when they decided they were scrapping the whole prototype community of tomorrow and going with kind of like a World's Fair sort of theme attraction, theme park. A pavilion just about energy was always planned, which I can't say that was always the case for most of the other pavilions. In fact, even its location where it stood, which now is where the Guardians of the Galaxy roller coaster is now, it was always planned to be right there. Like, it's funny because if you look at like the original concept art of like ideas for Epcot, like the land pavilion used to be where the Wonders of Life pavilion is now. So like everything always moved around, but Universe of Energy always stayed the same.
I wonder why.
Yeah. I was like, is it cause like placement of the
location?
Solar panels?
It could be something with that. So yeah. So the original idea was that this was going to be an attraction solely about solar energy. That was going to be the center focus of the entire attraction. And so they went around looking for sponsors, and they got a sponsor with Exxon. And they said, let's talk about all other sources of energy, not just solar. Who would have thought an oil company would be like, let's talk about oil. So they came on 1978.
Is Exxon's like mascot a dinosaur? Is that it?
No, that's
yeah. They used to have little dinosaurs to drive cars. They had the little mobile Exxon mobile. They had the cars. I don't want to talk too much about Exxon because we say anything wrong.
I know, right?
Oh, that's true.
they got gas money.
That's true.
So the original idea for this attraction was going to be an Omnimover. And if you don't know what an Omnimover attraction is, think Haunted Mansion or Little Mermaid type of attraction. And it's funny, though, because you see the original idea for it. They wanted to have, like, 24 people per vehicle.
That's pretty quick moving 24 people into a vehicle.
Yeah.
And that's where we ran into the first
hurdle. It's hard enough to get like three people on a vehicle.
That was kind of
the three, or is it two? I don't know.
That was kind of the general consensus as to why this didn't become an Omni Mover attraction.
I wish I was there for when they're like, "All right, you're gonna get 24 people." Oh, really? You're gonna get 24 people on this? Okay, let's see.
Right.
Let's get 24 healthy people. Right. And to do this, if this even possible with that.
So yeah, so they kind of struggled looking for a different ride system, and they looked back to the 1964-65 World's Fair, to another attraction, not a Disney one, but one called The American Journey. And they basically had this vehicle system where it's basically they describe it as picture yourself sitting in, like, you know, the stands at a high school basketball game, and that's being dragged around by, like, a tractor.
So bleachers.
Yes. It was called the, moving grandstands with a driver. That's what it was called. Disney
with
was
a driver.
Right. We don't like guests on their own.
With a driver.
The guy with the microphone means I'm the one in charge.
And so Disney didn't want a driver. They wanted it to move on its own. And they found a company called, was it Edgman Automation of Holland, where they had wire-guided driverless vehicles for warehouse and office transportation. And so Disney saw this and it goes, we can turn that into a ride vehicle. And so this vehicle was huge. It was massive. So it was 29 feet long, 19 feet wide. Okay. It could fit about just under 100 guests at a time. And they had,
Yeah, you're like in and out with your microphone.
Sorry. I'm trying to look at my.
It's like, you'll be like, one moment you'll come and talk like this. And I'm like, oh, you sound great. And then the one you're like, I'm a little out here.
Maybe. Yeah.
Gotcha.
Sorry, I threw you off. Your mojo was all
I know.
We're just getting used to having something in our faces. We're talking.
Yes. Get used to it. All of a sudden, sound very far away. My headphones make it so that's hard for me.
It limits
to do,
you.
So it forces me to lean in a little bit more. So it's a very large vehicle. Holds about just about 100 people per vehicle. And each go through the attraction, they have about 5 to 6 of these vehicles running at the same time for each show/ride through, which they have like 2 running at one
Didn't they
time.
Sort of had something like going on? Did they have like a lot of vehicles going on at the same time, or was it just one vehicle?
I can't remember. They had 6 to 5 vehicles running at the same time.
Yeah.
So
that's what I thought.
And I'll get into how the ride functioned and moved around. But this was kind of the beginning of trackless vehicles.
Yeah.
For
on technology. I was just thinking that, like, oh, this technology led to what we know in, like, Rise of the Resistance.
Correct.
Ratatouille.
Yeah, so, like, it started there, then it went to the Great Movie Ride. The Great Movie Ride is the same. It literally, the vehicles are the same except smaller. Technically, in Universe of Energy, there was a spot for kind of like a driver. And so when they moved that same ride system over to Great Movie Ride, they just put in the driver. Because when the ride would break down at Universe of Energy, it wouldn't start back up where the vehicle was. It had to go back to the beginning. So they would have to manually drive the vehicles back to the start.
Oh my goodness.
In order for it to restart properly.
That sounds like a nightmare.
Oh, yeah. Yes. So very massive, very large. It opened opening day 1982 on October 1st, but it was dedicated.
No way, mine opened up that day too.
Right,
what?
But it was dedicated on October 4th, because they were giving each attraction their own
special day,
and that was its designated day. And it was an extremely cheesy dedication with lots of, it's a spectacular to watch. It was definitely a different time in Disney history watching how they
it would have
been
bad if like they open up all the rides at the same time, and you're like all excited as a new cast member, like, oh, this is great, opening day, and no one shows up to your opening. Everybody's at Spaceship Earth, and you're just like, we got living off the land, veggie, veggie, fruit. You know, like, they're like, nah, not for me.
Nah.
How sad would that be? It's like,
I
no,
want
to
learn how papers.
I want to make sure everybody gets their own special attention.
Right. So, yeah, I know, totally. So basically the general idea of the attraction was it had a 9-minute pre-show with a 24-minute ride through. So you're sitting there for over 30 minutes for this attraction. It's a long attraction.
I lost my wallet on that ride.
Fast moving vehicle.
I know. I was like,
how did you lose your wallet?
It wasn't a very good back pocket.
But a lot of the inspiration behind this attraction came back to the World's Fair with the Ford Skyway attraction.
I was like, didn't you review that one?
I'm trying to read it off my paper, and I wrote it on the wrong line here. So the Ford Magic Skyway. And so, because in there they went back to the time of cavemen, and there were dinosaurs, and eventually those dinosaurs made their way over to Disneyland because Walt Disney was all like, I want to keep them. I don't know where to put them. So he put them on the train tracks. So why not? So when they were like, oh, we can do like a history of how we got fossil fuels and things like that. So they decided, and they still had the original molds from the World's Fair. So some of the same looking dinosaurs were basically brought over for this attraction with a ton of others. So like this had a ton of animatronics. They had 36 animatronics.
That's a lot.
With millipedes and snails and dinosaurs, and yeah, it was quite impressive for an attraction that was probably 70% watching a movie.
Yeah.
I remember, I was like, there's a lot of movies in that.
There's a lot of movie, but yeah. There's a lot of animatronic. But it's also the first place where the Smellitzer was used.
Really?
Oh, yeah, you smell.
They had a smell of kind of like swampy, musky smell, and people eventually complained, and they turned that off. But eventually that made its way over to Spaceship Earth and into, you know, Main Street USA, blowing that candy.
You
want to
know how they made that swampy smell?
Mold.
It was actually by accident. Somebody put their jock strap in front of the AC, and they're like, man, it smells pretty musky in here. I don't know about this.
It's like the ET ride at Universal, and you walk in, you're like, this smells like mold.
They also had, at the time, they had its largest fog machine ever developed. They also had this really massive rain effect that like rained everywhere, and they eventually turned it off. You want to guess why?
Because it shorted all the animatronics out.
Didn't short them out. Not just maintenance, money. It's just money.
Money's always money. Why everything goes away. All the cool effects go away for that reason.
Another interesting fact, so like when you get to the dinosaur portion, which I'll talk more about how you get to that point, they have two diorama backdrops 515 feet wide and 32 feet high, hand painted.
That's impressive.
Is crazy, like how much work that went into that. Now they just print that and just plaster that right on the wall. Yes. So that's kind of like the random facts of the attraction.
They had the one cool feature, which was like the unique thing, was the screen when you first get into the building.
Oh, the pre-show. I'm about
the pre-show.
To talk about
oh,
that.
Oh, yeah.
Yes. Oh, yeah. That's a big part here.
Yeah.
Is their like pre-show with their like moving cubes, which is it was probably one of the more impressive things of the attraction is the pre-show, was these like
mosaic screens.
Right. So it's basically kind of think of it kind of like projection mapping, but not projection mapping.
Yeah.
But like they had these like rotating cubes that would like rotate, and it would like make the different images they needed to for the show they're talking about.
Yeah, there were 100 rotating shape screens.
Right.
It's a lot.
Yes. And so so in this pre-show, they just talk about what the different types of energy there are. You know, it's like there's wind and fire and light and things like that. And then they talk about how man uses energy today. And then they punch you with the theme song, which, honestly, in my opinion, probably one of the catchiest theme songs for EPCOT that was made during that time period.
Do you have a sample?
Like, I wonder what that will sound like.
I wonder. Yeah, I'm totally adding that in. Energy, these are a few of your faces, glowing in timeless places, bringing our lives new graces. About you, now is the time to find how to. Energy, you are profound, you make the world go round and round, you make the world go round. So yeah, that's when you first get introduced to that, and then you move into the attraction itself, where you get into this giant circular room, basically, surrounded by curtains, kind of like, I mean, our audience, you guys probably won't know this, but for my co-host here, kind of looking like the Senate Capri, where it's like everything's covered
in IMAX,
yeah, but like they've got these, like, gold curtains,
like Victorian style curtains,
right? So you get onto your vehicle, which is just looks like, you know, You find an empty spot, and you sit there, and it looks like you're theater seating, but you know you're in a vehicle, and so you're like, what's gonna happen? And then the attraction starts, and it like rotates you in front of three giant movie screens, where you spend the next while watching an animated sequence about the formation of fossil fuels and things like that. And it was
news alert.
Well, this was actually the more interesting. It's the snooze part comes the last part. I'll tell you that much.
Just start showing the dinosaurs.
After the dinosaurs
is like the peak.
That's the peak of like you have the kids' interest.
I think I rode the ride once when I lived there.
I didn't ride it at
all.
I
was like, this is bad.
Well, yeah.
After you lose your wallet, you're like, never again.
It's too intense for me.
The gas company's stealing my money. Oh.
Right.
Literally.
So it was actually like, it's an animated piece. So it's more engaging for children because it's animated. So it's like the kids are watching a cartoon. But like,
it's kind of like Jurassic Park when they're explaining how they made dinosaurs.
Dino DNA. Kind of. But the narrator's really boring. It's kind of like watching those old science movies from like school where they're like, it's not Bill Nye the Science Guy.
It's 1950s.
Just, watch as the dinosaur dies and it produces oil in the ground.
Billy, you know, has something different. He has arm hair. And I was like, I didn't sign up for that in this podcast.
But yeah, so you see that, and it was somewhat interesting. It was an interesting watch when I went back and watched the ride through of the original attraction. It didn't make the when they revamped it here, but it's all about the creation of the fossil fuels, and then your vehicle rotates again, and it goes forward into kind of the dinosaur diorama, where you visit different eras of history of the Earth. You know, I couldn't tell you at the top of the head the different paleontologic and creation, Jurassic, you know, I don't know all of those.
If you really want to make an archaeologist really mad, and like they're... And they tell you, oh, I'm an archaeologist. Be like, oh, you dig up dinosaur bones? That would be the quickest way to make
that's
them angry.
That's how you end the conversation.
Right. And so, yeah, so you're just going around, and some of these dinosaurs are quite scary. Like
Dinosaur the Ride scary?
I would honestly think it's scarier than Dinosaur the Ride, in my opinion. Like, looking at some of these dinosaurs, because they get, like, right there in your face, and they've got, like, sharp teeth. Like, it was, for its time, I would consider it quite scary. Originally, they were going to have it to be very heavy storms and things like that, but they're like, you know what? This attraction is pretty scary enough with these dinosaurs that we don't need to add, like, death, you know, deadly hurricanes. And
they didn't want to throw rain. In resource wars that we're going to have in the 21st century.
Right. And so then, you know, after you go through the dinosaur diorama, you go into the second theater where they kind of talk about how we use the different energy, you know, how we find oil and crude oil and things like that. They spent a good long while talking about oil. Who would have thought? And then at the end, they kind of talk a little bit about, oh yes, and there's also solar and nuclear wind and, you know, all of the other energies. And they talk.
But you can't listen to rock and roll with those in your vehicles, can you?
I just think of the Simpsons.
Oh, yeah.
The Simpsons.
One of us. Yes. One of us.
Oh, yeah. Totally. So, yeah. And they even make a point. They even show footage of the construction of the pavilion.
How exciting.
Yes. And so of them installing.
Not that we've monopolized 20 minutes of your time, but let's bore you with framing.
Well, yeah, because they talk about how part of the attraction is being energized by the building itself. As is it,
the exit signs.
15% of the attraction is being powered by it.
Yeah, I like how in the reading they're like, oh, there's solar panels and they're partially powering the attraction.
Partially.
Like, partially.
Right. It's kind of funny that they give you kind of like the behind, like, the scenes of how this ride is working. It's like, it charges when it's parked, when you're loading and unloading the vehicle.
It sounds like because they didn't have enough solar panels. There are 80,000 solar panels on this.
Oh, yeah. There was
building.
A ton.
That's a lot. Because if you think of, like, a house usually has, like, 4 to 8 panels.
Right. So, yeah, it had a ton. But then it kind of ends with kind of a upbeat, faster version of the original song. Here we go through the universe of energy. Here we grow, see it glow. It's the universe of energy. Universe of energy, kind of snazzy, and they kind of have like a. And then as you get off the attraction, they're playing an instrumental, which is even more snazzier sounding. And then there's a post. There was planned for a post show. Okay, so you leave the attraction, and they decided not to go with the post show, and decided just to put pictures of tigers up. It is the weirdest thing ever. It's all like random pictures of like tigers, just like what you would picture on like those like kid calendars of like, here's a tiger picture. It's like, why is this here?
It's those, like, group assignments for, like, school projects. You got the Imagineers that do all their different parts. And, like, you got the A-plus who did the dinosaur part. And then you got the post-show, and it's like...
He's like, I like tigers. My shirt has ligers on them. They're like, mystical beings.
There's, like, no explanation. There's just large pictures of tigers. There's, like, 5 of them. And it's like, what?
It's
kind of funny.
It's something to get the guests awake.
To wake them up. Wake the kids up. Because I'll tell you.
Dinosaurs. I'm glad that's over. Tigers.
That last part. When you're in that second. When you're watching that last part Oh my gosh, it is so boring. I was all like trying to like, okay, I need to skip ahead. Like,
it just reminds me of the Homer Simpson as he's flying over Epcot. He's like, oh, it's boring flying over it.
Oh yeah, oh yeah. That labels this attraction specifically.
Yet it's like one of the last ones that remain.
They did end the show with kind of like a, not necessarily like a laser show, but a laser show on the screen. So that was kind of interesting for its time. That looked dated really quickly.
It's kind of like the Star Wars CGI that they put in A New Hope. We're like, now we're going into the Death Star plans. And like 10 years later, it's like, man, we can't do anything. We have, that's the basis of our computer technology of the rebellion.
Right. Yeah. Totally. There's even another post show. But it was in another pavilion. It was in the Communicore building, which would later be called Innoventions. But it was another called the Energy Exchange, sponsored by Exxon. And so it was just a bunch, a pavilion showing the different types of how we use different fuels. It's the place where we first see the exercise bikes that power televisions, that you can try out, which eventually make their way over to the Wonders of Life Pavilion. There was even a game they had, a game where you drove a taxi and your goal was to use the least amount of gas as possible. Sounds exciting, right?
Ooh. Reminds me of going to Target and playing like Crazy Taxi, and you're like jumping over and trying to get to the point A to point B. But that doesn't sound as, like, it probably was not nearly as exciting.
In the 80s? Early 80s, probably.
That's right, they had Pong.
Yeah. Boop. So eventually, you know, this attraction lasts a long time. In the 90s, everything in Epcot started looking really dated, really bad. Things started falling apart. All the sponsors for all the other pavilions were jumping ship. They're like, we don't want to pay for this anymore. We're leaving. Exxon stayed on. And they says, let's refurbish this thing. And so they...
Yeah, they made it more interesting.
They you know, you know, like right now, everyone's talking about how like everything's based off an IP. Well, in the 90s, everything was based off of celebrities.
Yes. Yep. Celebrities were big.
And so their plan was like, okay, well, what we're going to do is we're gonna bring in Ellen because she just started
She's
with ABC.
Comedian.
Same with Bill Nye, the science guy. And
Bill Nye, the science guy. Bill.
Yes. And they started syndicating for Jeopardy. So Alex Trebek was in it.
He was in there.
So they're like, yeah, this is what we're going to do. And we're going to make it, if we're going to call it Ellen's Energy Crisis. And they quickly changed that name because that scared a lot of people. Who wants to go on an attraction? Like, the Energy Crisis.
It's not like in high school when they show, I have this one teacher who just show us documentaries of how all the ways the earth is going to end. And I'm like, this is depressing.
I took a college class about that. There are many different ways. And I had to write a paper about, like, I had to pick one. And I was like, oh, I'm doing the man-made version, which is nuclear war. So I just got to watch nuclear war, like, movies and, like, write, like, a 12-page paper. I did really well on that paper.
But, so that happened. Well, while they were in the middle of that transformation, the rest of Epcot was also closed. So Horizons had closed. The World of Motion was closed. And so they're like, well, can we get Universe of Energy open for at least the summer? Because it closed on January 20th of 96. But halfway through their work on changing it into the Ellen's Energy Adventure, they're like, we need more attractions in Epcot. So they opened it up. They got rid of the cubes for the pre-show. It was like on one screen and it looked really bad.
Yeah, they got
really
rid of the best part.
They got rid of the best part of the attraction, minus the dinosaurs. They got rid of some of the effects. I think there was a volcano that they turned into a waterfall effect. You know,
there was going to be an animatronic of Ellen. And,
well, it was already installed.
But it wasn't finished.
It was. They covered it up with a rock.
Yeah, they put a rock over it.
Yes. And so, and they even did recording for this summer run of this version of it. They even, because they mentioned the year specifically. welcome back to 1996. And so that was the only time they used it, was for this summer run, but it was a really bad shape looking universe of energy.
I can't believe it's been 25 years.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so then that fall, like, and then after the summer, they closed it and finished it off. And then by the fall, I think in November, it became Ellen's Energy Adventure from that point on.
With my attraction, they had to, like, reopen it because
yes,
your ride went down and then Test Track was going back up.
Right.
Or was getting renovated. And they're like, well, we need something over here. You're up, Horizons.
Jack, you want to add anything else?
Yeah, so they did the renovation, and it was a little... The people that watched it were like, it's a little better.
It was comedic. there was comedy. You know,
there was some comedy parts in it. It wasn't as, like, a boring, like, science teacher narrating.
Oh, it was like a... Yeah. It was
But...
Now you had Bill Nye, the science guy.
But the show got longer. It was like 45 minutes with the new
renovated. I remember being really long. Yeah,
that's why I only wrote it once. Because like, I was all like, this took up my day.
I'm like, oh, 45 minutes for a show that's like snooze fest? Like, if the chairs were comfortable, totally fine.
I'd be fine if Exxon gave me a free gallon of gas. Like, we could make a gas card. Then I'd be like, let's do this. Like, I'm just like,
I'll ride this all day.
Every CP who has a car is rewriting that ride over
it's
and
my
over.
Day off. What are you going to do? Gotta go to get my gas card.
I gotta get my gas card.
The attraction ended. It closed 2017.
Yes.
Is when they closed. And the funny part is, like, there was a ton of people that wanted to ride the last ride-through. And so there was a huge wait just for the last ride-through. They got on the last ride, and the attraction just stopped right at the dinosaur part.
I guarantee you the cast members purposely turned it off because they were just like... Because
they knew it was filled with fans. Oh, and absolutely. To give them the best magical moment ever.
Walk and so, an evacuation.
A slow evacuation.
Yeah, basically they evac'd and like the cast members were like, oh, slowly get out. But like everyone was touching the animatronics.
Taking pictures.
Videos. I'm surprised they didn't take teeth off the dinosaur.
I'm sure someone did. like all the guests were like up in these animatronics like space. And then the attraction closed. And you wonder, there was an animatronic of Ellen, which you wonder what happened to that.
Oh, it's in Ellen's house. She has it like in her bedroom. What's going on, Ellen?
So, collector, he's on YouTube, I think, bought it. And, for Ellen's birthday, the cat of the show.
Well, she was asking for it. Ellen was like asking.
She was asking what was going on.
Because the attraction closed, she goes, yeah, whatever happened to my animatronic? I want to see my animatronic.
It's like Terminator style. It's got like a red eye and he's like melting.
Almost. Yeah. So it was like on her birthday show or whatnot, they brought the animatronic out and it is terrifying. Like, oh,
she's all like, get this thing out of here.
It is literally terrifying because the animatronic, like the machine itself, is not there,
right?
It's just like the skin of it.
Yeah, it's just
so it doesn't have like the strong like jaw features and like
did you put it on her face like Dwight did with the mannequin in the office?
She was like, can we get this out? This was not me.
And that's how you re-prank, you know, Alan, by sticking that like dummy or that animatronic skin everywhere.
All right. I think that's good. We can move on here. I didn't necessarily want to go too much detail about Ellen's energy adventure.
It's entertaining.
It was just kind of a fun story to share about her animatronic. So, but... I want to kind of keep it about 80s Epcot attractions. So now we'll move on to Japheth here. He's going to tell us all about Horizons.
Yes, I have Horizons with an S.
Bring back Horizons.
Oh, man. So I pick Horizons because IE worked at the ride that replaced it. And when I mean replaced it, bulldoze that sucker down.
Yes, it was completely gone. It was a big building, too.
Yeah, and it was like huge. The space coffin. Is that what they called it or something like that?
Something like that. It did look like a coffin.
It had this, like, what was it? Like a hexagon front, and then, like, it stretched and elongated to the back.
Right.
So Horizons opened up, like everyone else, in October 1st, 1982. It was open for 16 years. It had a refurbishment. I was like, I didn't think they had refurbished. I put refurb there. I was like, it's like, did they really refurb? No, they just shut it down because it was broken. And they're like, well, we'll wait till somebody wants to sponsor us.
The sponsor pulled out and they didn't want to pay for the maintenance. And so, yeah.
So, and then it eventually closed in 1999. And I think they did bring it back after 95 because, like I said, Test Track was getting built.
Yep.
And then, like, one of their vehicles crashed into the building. Yes. Did you ever hear about that?
Oh, so I went on like a backstage tour when I was a cast member for, is it a Fantastic? No, it was for like the monorail system, which was a really boring backstage tour. But the guy that was on that tour worked on like Test Track and like the pre-mates, and they had to like test track and the speed, and like the cars would fly off the track.
Yeah. And so one of the stories is a guy wanted to go to lunch early, so he jumped in one vehicle and it was good. The car after him flew into the building, literally through the building. And he's like, well, I'm glad I was impatient. Yeah, because he probably would have died. You know, those convertibles are going to protect anything.
Right. There were no airbags in that car.
So let's go back to a boring ride, Horizons. I'm knocking it, but I think it's a really sophisticated, really cool ride that really shows like Imagineers pushing the limits to their capabilities at this time.
There's a reason why this attraction has the fan base that it does. Like, it's a cool idea, and it's, people call it a sequel to another one of Walt's classic attractions. So
I think so. It really builds upon it.
The Carousel of Progress.
So it is a dark ride. It has two floors.
Yes.
And the way it loads up, it's like Peter Pan, but it's on one side. So you're facing, what is it, the left side or is it the right side? I can't remember. But you're only facing one side, and you're just going around. And you go scene to scene. And I'll go through, like, the many different scenes. Right. And so, as Peter said, it was sponsored, like most attractions were. They sponsor it, they approve what the Imagineers come up with, and then they pay for it, and they maintain it. It was, like, such a genius plan somebody realized, like, I don't have to pay for this. Why are we paying for this? So I can put my logo on here? Nah, I'm good. So they General Electric's, you know, Edison, his company, so they had the motto, if we can dream it, we can ice cream it. No, sorry, that's Cold Stone Creamery. If we can dream it, then we can do it. Oh, yeah, it's like, wow, it's motivating. And then it has Tomorrow's Horizons Are Here Today. And I'm like, that is so confusing. Tomorrow's Horizons Are Here Today. Wait, tomorrow. Well, if it's today, is it really Tomorrow's Horizon? Or I don't know. That's why I was like, maybe I'm just too stupid to understand it. But I was all like, wait, tomorrow? Day? I don't know. So construction planning began in 1979, and then it actually started in 1982. And so I worked with a guy, the maintenance guy, I don't remember his name, but he liked working there with all the college students because like all the girls would give him hugs. And I was like, why are you working here so long? It's all like, where else am I gonna get hugs from 20-year-old girls that like greet me every day like
that's creepy.
Well, if they're giving it willingly, I mean,
he wasn't like, give me a hug for an hour. No, it was just like, he was a nice guy, and he was very sweet. He would come around, he'd give you candy. Okay, maybe he's not so sweet.
Did he really give candy?
He did. He would give you lollipops. He was a really nice guy, though. He was really cool, and he talked about the last attraction where they were putting it together, and he showed up like 3 months before, and like
it was just like a pile of dirt in the middle of a building. It was like, we're going to have all, he was a projectionist, and that's how he got the job. And so he was like, he walked around there and he's like, you're going to have this done in 3 months. He's like, okay. Sure enough, it got done. So this ride is an omni, it's an omnisphere. Is that what they call it?
Something
I don't know.
Like that.
So it's like Peter Pan. It's always loading, and it's like a 20-minute ride, but it never really had a line because it was efficient.
Yep.
And it was good at what it did.
There was no pre-show to gunk up the line.
No, you just jump on, and it's a long ride. And I was like, man, we miss these long rides that cool you down in these days.
Right.
Yeah.
And it's kind of like the fault, I think, of Epcot and how it's designed. Like, you're automatically going to get the first part done, which is the cooler part of the day. And then when you get to the World Showcase, you're just dying in this cement, like, circle of doom. Right. And then you're just like, what's the next show? Oh, it's a standing theater?
Standing show.
Whose genius idea is this?
Oh, my goodness.
And then you get to the French Pavilion, and it smells all swampy, and you're like, okay, why is this swampy smell here? So, they're on this ride. It shows, like, the past, present, and future of inventions and where mankind is going to go. Let's see. They have 90-foot wide dome screens. They have two of these. And I remember writing it and just seeing this ginormous screen with, like, they showed, like, the double helix.
Yes.
And I was like, that's a trip right there. So it's, I mean, that's just fun. So, like, just imagine going through on a ride and seeing the projection screen of what's it called? The
Soarin',
yeah. And sure enough, in Soarin', one of the scenes, they have orange smell sprayed in there. And I saw that. I was like, oh, great.
Yep.
It smells like oranges in here. let's see. So the guests were immersed in scenes depicting the future, and they can choose one of three destinations at the end. So that was kind of, you know, choose your path kind of thing. It was majority picked. And did the guests really get to pick it? It's hard to say, or if it was randomly.
They did. So what it was is that, like, everyone on the vehicle,
they got to pick something.
They got to pick one, and then it would basically pick randomly, you know, one of the options.
Oh, they randomly.
It would just randomized. Well,
or did they just randomize it themselves? They're like, oh, someone picked this one. Because who's picking that? Like, let's go to the desert, to Mesa Verde. No, no one wants.
Right.
Everyone wants to do space.
I know. I remember we have our home video of Father Yodler. He got all excited when space was selected. He goes, all right, space.
So the ride starts, you know, it shows the clouds, and they show you, like, past future inventions of Jules Verne from, like, Earth to the Moon, where the bullets launch into the moon, into the eye, you know, in that scene of that movie. And then you see the famous robot butler.
Yes.
And they have, like, great big Beautiful Tomorrow playing in there. So kind of a little, like, tip of the nod to that ride. They have the projections of past aviations. Then you go to the future according to the 50s, which lots of neon lights and flashy. Kind of looks like New Orleans. you get the liquid space where you're, like, in water. And you got DNA chain scene with a double helix. I thought that was really cool. And they talk about sun energy and space travel and space colonies. I mean, if you're hopeful for the future, this is really good.
This would be an attraction that Elon Musk would be like, I love this thing.
He probably was the nerd. My favorite part's the space colonies.
Right.
It's the best.
He's like, hey, Mesa Verde, why can't that be Mars? You know?
Yeah, terraform it. I mean, it kind of builds that, like, you got to think, like, we were on the moon in the late 60s, and it's all like, all right, what's next? Like, we're going to be going to other planets and stuff. And then you learn, like, how far and how long it takes. You're like, oh, maybe not. Mm-hmm. We got to learn how to freeze people. Well, it's like, I got you covered. I'm on it. they talk about cityscapes. Oh, they did talk about satellite imagery. And I was like, oh, my goodness, they're talking about GIS mapping and using that to help you interpret crops and what's good and what's not. And I was like, oh, cool. That were, they were edgy right there.
Right.
It was prime.
Dragon's like, riveting. Imagery of crops. Amazing. So they talk about cityscapes and then computer chips and the house of the future. Kind of has like the 70s modern and right. Like they're doing FaceTime.
Yep.
And they're like on the screen. So you look at it, it's like, oh, it's cool. It's kind of like we willed the future right there. They go back to, let's see, they show more of the desert with robot spacecrafts, like kind of terraform. And they show like their leisure time, and then they show the marine biology boyfriend and the family in a floating sea in the floating city. And like you have like this little like what is it, like a sea otter in right. there. I was fascinated with a kid. He's got like little fin shoes.
Oh yeah.
And you get the space, they show the cool space station with astronauts floating and then spaceships and bike rides up in space. And people doing floating and space mining, and they're like, wow, it's kind of like they're, I mean, this is supposed to be the 21st century, and it's kind of like, you know, what our younger generation will probably see is that mining of asteroids.
Very realistic to yeah. what the future could look like. It's, yeah.
I still want those, like, sea colonies.
Yeah.
You know, like, it kind of form like, no, we're not, we're in international water. We can form our own kind of, like.
You want a Gungan city.
Yes.
We's under the water.
I'm waiting for you to do like the bombass leader.
Hey, you saw, stop by there.
Or he's like doing the.
Yeah.
And so it launches you back into your final three choices, which is space, the desert area, and I think it was the water one.
Yeah.
The video that they showed was the space one, which was really cool. I mean, the ride and all cost $60 million. I think they really push with the amount of animatronics.
Right.
And it's like right up Walt's area, but it's not what the average ride person really wants.
Right.
They wanted thrills. And like you see it like today's Epcot. It's all been replaced with thrill rides.
With thrills. Yeah. Yep. Well, that's one of the reasons why we kind of started with Epcot East, because that's all different now. All what was there is now gone. There's nothing.
I think Spaceship Earth's the only thing that
That's the closest thing we have to that section of the park as to something that's somewhat similar to what was there before. Then you get over to the west side. That stuff's there's some of that stuff. That's
it's hard to get rid of a big water tank,
right? So. Or a giant greenhouse.
Yeah.
That you use to feed your theme parks.
They got rid of like pretty much all the animatronics. They're like, this is too much money. We cannot do this.
Right.
So the ride, you know, like I said, closed in 1999, and then Mission Space took it, which is a centrifuge, like, launch into space. Jackie loves that ride.
I love that attraction.
I've ridden it, like, 3 times. Even though I really? Work there, it just messes me up.
Oh, okay.
I would get off and be like, whoa, that was intense.
We didn't get to it on our last trip.
Were you disappointed?
So. I was kind of disappointed I hadn't done we missed that one and Test Track, so we weren't able to do either one of those. But we did everything else.
I just love the feeling of my skin, like, falling off my spine.
You do feel that pressure that gets to your face, and that is a cool sensation.
But then after that, it's like, okay, can we be done now? The cool part's over.
Yeah.
then it's just recovery.
I enjoyed working at Mission Space. I just didn't enjoy the ride, like, itself. From working there, I would always get those like 40 to 50 year olds. I'd be like, you know what? They need to tear this building down and put Horizons back. And it's like, sir, that's not going to happen.
No, it won't.
If it sucked then, it's going to suck now. All right. So let's not kid ourselves.
It suck then. It just didn't get fixed up. Nobody did anything
to
it to
like,
upkeep
it. They could like modernize Horizon and put in like Tomorrowland?
No.
If they can't fix... love them to do that. I wish they would. put that at where the at Disneyland, put it where the Interventions building is.
What? You're not excited for the new DVC, the DVC lounge?
No. No.
Yeah. Mm-mm.
It's always been the big question. What do you do with this big round building?
Oh, I think the whole building should go, but I think in its place you put like a Horizons type attraction. I think that land needs a people eater, and I think Horizons is a perfect people eater attraction.
It literally eats people.
Oh, it's like my Hall of Presidents. Oh, yeah. It's a kidnapper show where kids take naps. Wait, it didn't sound like that one. No. That's a wrong title. Right. Grover Cleveland eats your kids. How do you think he stays so plump all these years? So what did I say? Did I say how much it costs?
No.
It costs $60 million. That's a lot of money from back then.
That's a lot of money.
And how much did Disneyland cost when it first opened?
Oh no, we just answered this.
I know.
What was it? 11 million?
Remember the day.
Was it the 17?
17 million.
17 million.
That's good. That helps.
Yes, 17 million to build Disneyland. And this cost, was it 56?
60 million.
60 million.
Yeah.
And the ride still wasn't good.
It was good.
You know, as I watched, I was like, oh, this is really cool. And like, we don't have a lot of rides that do that hope for the future.
Right.
The hope for the future was torn down because of a sinkhole and part of the building, right. And that's why they couldn't really reuse it. So yeah. There's your hope. It's been torn down and turned into a parking lot. Right. All right. So yeah, that kind of sums up Horizons. I think it's a cool ride. I don't know if it would be still appealing to guests now. I think it would be
not as long as it was.
No,
like if it was maybe like a 10-minute attraction, it would probably have legs.
It was supposed to be longer too.
Oh, I know.
They cut the budget. They cut it by like It was supposed to be 30% longer.
Oh yeah, they're trying to compete against Universe of Energy.
Which one can kill the will to live in this park?
Right.
I just want an AC attraction where you go through different parts. Oh, this is a different type of air conditioning unit, and this is a different.
This is sponsored by HVAC.
And look at this comfy chair that you can sleep in.
This is sponsored by Lazy Boy.
That's the sponsorship ride we all are asking for.
Every adult is like, we're going on this. We're going on this.
It's like our famous game we played once as a family. Like, what game we play? The nap game.
Who could take the nap?
I won with this. A 4-hour nap.
I hate that nap. I hate the nap game. I could never nap as a kid.
That's all I've got.
All right. Well, thank you for sharing. This was a fun adventure back into old 80s Epcot. My favorite. What I want to bring back.
Yeah, it could stay back there.
I'm actually okay with the removal of Universe of Energy. That one. I'll give me back the song, but you can keep the attraction.
The song was really cool.
Yeah.
All the songs were really good. And George McGinnis was the, like, he designed a lot of the songs.
Yes, he did. For most of Epcot.
Oh, no, sorry. George Wilkins. Sorry.
Yes.
Wilkins. I had George McGinnis design the ride. The music was done by George Wilkins.
He did a lot of the music for Epcot. Things from, I believe he did, like the America.
Yeah.
He did, was it the Canada song?
I don't remember the specifics of which
and
one.
And I think he did Listen to the Land.
He did do that one.
So, yeah, like, did a lot. So, and he did really good, and all that music's really catchy. Horizons one, I'm actually kind of on their song.
It can't be as bad as the reentry for Emission Space. They had this one girl bellowing out, and it was on a loop every, like, minute and a half, and it's like, if you're stuck in reentry, it was like 40 minutes of just like pushing your limits.
Right. Yeah, a lot of people didn't like the temporary nighttime show for Epcot. Their what was it called? Epcot Forever, because they had children singing all these songs. Well, the Horizons song was children singing the whole thing, and so people were like, it's too creepy listening to these kids sing these songs that are like 30 years older than them.
She's like, get rid of it. Yeah. We're done.
So, all right. Well, it was fun, exciting. We might do the other parts of Epcot because, honestly, Epcot is not the same park that it used to be. So, let us know what you think. Have any of you guys ridden any of these two attractions or the other Epcot attractions that used to be? Let us know. You can check us out on our, you can write us on our Facebook, our Instagram. You can email us at matterhornyodelers@gmail.com. It's at Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. And yeah. Until next time, auf Wiedersehen.
Thank you for joining us on this week's episode of the Matterhorn Yodelers. Please remember, before your bobsled comes to a complete stop, to follow us on Facebook and Instagram. And remember...